Shall we wait for Sudhir,
I think you start. We'll call him here and join.
Okay, yeah, namaste and good evening, everyone. Welcome to the 43rd session of the Tuesday lecture series presented by Vigyan Prasad for Vigyan Prasad Network of Science Club. And I am your Dr. Nidhi Srivastava, project scientist from Vigyan Prasad. It's my privilege to welcome the esteemed panelist of today's session, Shri Sudhir Kumar sir, associate director, capacity building program office in ISRO. Dr. Arvind Siranade, senior scientist from Vigyan Prasad and national coordinator of VIPNET clubs, and Mr. Vipin Singh Rawal from the VIPNET team of Vigyan Prasad. I also welcome all the club members who have joined us for this session today. Thank you everyone for taking time out and being here. Space sciences is the study of study and research of the issues specifically related to the space travel and space exploration. And nowadays, it uses new space age technologies like satellite positioning, space data visualizations, analysis tools, and space data interpretation to greatly advance the scientific understanding of Earth and its systems. The last decade has witnessed a great advancement in the efforts of scientists around the world to understand the space. So in today's lecture, we are going to learn about the fundamentals of space sciences and technology. And for that, we have a speaker, Shri Sudhir Kumar ji, Associate Director, Capacity Building Program Office, ISRO. The talk will be as usual of 40 to 50 minutes, followed by interaction session. I appeal and request to all the listeners that you can type your queries and questions in the comment section of the YouTube box. Once the session is over, we will take your questions. Now, I invite Arvind sir to please welcome our today's speaker and introduce it to our audience. Over to Arvind sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Nidhi. हमारे सभी विज्ञान प्रसार के संचारक और प्रचारक जो पूरे भारत में विज्ञान का काम कर रहे हैं, ऐसे सभी को मैं आज के 43वें मंगलवार व्याख्यान श्रृंखला में आपका स्वागत करता हूं। और जैसा आपने देखा है कि लगातार विज्ञान प्रसार की तरफ से एक प्रयास होता है कि आपके बीच में विज्ञान एवं प्रौद्योगिकी, अभियांत्रिकी, ऐसे नए नए विषय के बारे में नए जानकार व्यक्ति आपके बीच में आए और आपको विषय की गहराई और विषय की संपूर्णता आपके पास पहुंचाने के लिए हम हमेशा प्रयत्न करते हैं। और स्पेशली जो हमारी मंगलवार व्याख्यान श्रृंखला है, वो लगभग आज 43वां व्याख्यान उसी श्रृंखला में निरंतर हम करते आ रहे हैं, उसके लिए स्वाभाविक है कि हमारे बीच में डॉक्टर सुधीर जी जैसे विशेष वक्तागण हमारे बीच में आकर उन्होंने बहुत अच्छा हमारे साथ एक अच्छा संबंध जुड़ा हुआ है और उसका प्रयास हम हमेशा करते आ रहे हैं। सो आई ऑल्सो फील लाइक इट्स रियली अ ग्रेट प्रिविलेज फॉर विज्ञान प्रसार टू गेट द एमिनेंट स्पीकर्स फ्रॉम द वैरायटी ऑफ टॉपिक्स विच आर वेरी वेरी कॉन्टेम्पररी इन द नेचर एंड द स्पीकर्स हु रियली हैव वर्कड हार्ड इन देयर टॉप इन देयर रिसर्च एज वेल एज द वर्क दैट दे कैरी ऑन। एंड वी आर रियली फॉर्चुनेट टू हैव टूडे स्पीकर हु belongs to a very, I would say the pinnacle institute of the, government of India. And of course, every citizen of the country is proud when we talk about an Indian Space Research Organization. So today we have got Dr. Sudhir Kumar ji, who has been engineer by profession, and he has contributed a lot, especially in the space technology and of course in the space sciences. So it is a great privilege for me to introduce him. To just for the information, sir, we have got more than 3,500 science club across the country, and majority of these science clubs are run by these schools, and there are good amount of our clubs which are out of the school network as well. There are good science activists who are running these club all across the country, and nearly 40% of our clubs are outside the school network. And there are great enthusiasts and hardworking science activists who work for bringing the latest knowledge of science to the people, and a good amount of people are working from across the country. So this lecture series is to enrich their knowledge and give them scientific inputs on the various topics that India at frontline research that we carry out. So I thank you so much for you to come on this platform. And for the sake of all the, you know, our VIPnet club coordinators across the country, I would like to introduce our speaker, Dr. Sudhir Kumarji. Sudhir Kumarji is working as an associate director at Capacity Building Program Office at Indian Space Research Organization headquartered in Bangalore. He is responsible for industrialization, indigenization, technology transfer, intellectual property right, technical infrastructure and outreach activities of ISRO. Dr. Sudhir Kumarji, after completing his post-graduation in industrial engineering, served in the Tata Steel for about 6 years, where he implemented various quality systems. He also worked with the McKinsey and Booz Allen Hamilton in the implementing various projects. After joining ISRO, he developed enterprise software solution for ISRO for handling procurement, store, finance, accounts, and human resources. Dr. Sudhirji also responsible for realizing Asia's largest solid rocket propellant plant at SDSC SHAR, Sriharikota, state-of-the-art mission control center facilities for GSLV Mach 3 project, radar and critical equipment for ground system. He is a deputed for the space studies program at International Space University, Austria during 2011. And I personally also know Dr. Sudhirji. He is such a down-to-earth personality, and he is always, you know, happy and shows his interest to come forward for the benefit of all of you, our club coordinators. And I have never seen a personality who is such a simple, by the nature. And we always get a great amount of support from him as we go ahead. And I can promise you in his presence that he, being in such a novel and very down-to-earth personality, we will get all the required up-to-date informations from the ISRO, which are supposed to be communicated to the large section of society in days to come. And thank you so much, Dr. Sudhirji, being part of this lecture series, which is in place almost about to be a year now. And we welcome you, and I request you to please deliver the talk for the benefit of our students and the club coordinators across the country. Dhanyavad, namaskar.
Thank you, Arunji. Bahut achha baat kiya hai hamara taraf se. I suppose let me thank first VIPnet Vignan Prasar for giving me an opportunity to put it my whatever the little knowledge I have across to the little people who are enthusiastic to listen to the space activities in and around the country. Probably I think this what I thought is, since it is a first session, we can touch little about the fundamentals and initial days of space technology, space development across the world, then what we are doing in India as a part of ISRO. Probably I think subsequently when some more lectures are organized, we can have a focused discussion on to, let us say, how actually the satellite will be developed or launch vehicle will be developed, such kind of intricate things. How, what are the different technologies that are available in space? So to start with, I am really glad to share my thoughts and whatever I have to speak for the next 40 to 50 minutes. Straight away, I'll go to the presentation.
Sure. Thank you.
Hope the presentation is visible. See, today, yes, the space science and technology, this science, unless otherwise it is put into application in a meaningful way, it is of no use. We have been listening to the space science for last, I should say, 1960s, I think more than 80 years or maybe 60 years. But advanced nations have taken the space science in a different way in addition to the normal circumstances. But India has taken this space science exclusively for the common man, I should say. The pioneers who conceived the space science in India, like Vikram Sarabhai, after that the baton was taken over by Professor Satish Dhawan. They have shaped the space science and technology in such a way that the common man will get always benefited out of it. So with this preamble, thanking to the saluting the pioneers who conceived this program. I'll just land into the topic. The space always a fascination for explorers and scientists. What is not seen with your naked eye and what is going on in the universe would always be an enthusiastic topic, right from the child to the most veteran scientists who have been nurturing the space sciences. To start with, let us say how the universe was generated. It is a singularity concept, and lot of our ancient literatures like Rig Veda, everything they say about the genesis of universe. But one thing is, we have to understand that language. We have to go to a knowledgeable person. In Nasadiya Sukta, it is very clearly written. In the Purusha Sukta also, it is written how the evolution has happened. There used to be the concept is there used to be a singularity. That means every matter is getting concluded or getting into the inside of within itself, and ultimately a huge pressure would have built up. That pressure has blown out, which we call it as Big Bang theory. And over a billion of years, the small stars and different kind of space objects have been formed on cooling over a billion of, over 15 billion years. That was the Big Bang theory, what it says to us on the evolution of the universe. Of course, what it contains in the universe, it could be 70% of the dark energy, dark matter, and only 5% is only the actual matter, which matter contains stars, planets, asteroids. The dark energy, that is what this says, energy is only the source of creating entire thing. The Shakti is the source for creating the matter. This is perfect example of our literature, what it says. The source of everything is Shakti. We call it as, somebody call it as power, somebody call it as energy, somebody call it as Shakti. Okay, this is the ultimate source for converting the entire planets or entire matter. Of course, galaxy contains stars. What a galaxy contains? It all contains stars, clouds, gas, different kinds of materials, which ultimately gives birth to nebulas, asteroids, comets, planets, etc., etc. But it is told based on the literature. It was told that the nebulas are the largest sources of creating the planetary system. Okay, emission of nebulas are extremely bright and can contain stars within. Reflection nebula doesn't contain the star. That's what the philosophy says. These are all one can go through the Google and get to know more about these topics. The comet is the one described by Frederick Whipple as nothing more than a dirty snow ball that travels through the space. You could have seen this kind of comets, etc., in the open sky when you are, fortunately, when you are just looking at the sky during the night time. The asteroids, meteorites were created when the universe was created or as a result of collision. These are all the some of the space objects what you come across normally. So when you come into our system, our galaxy, what we call it as Milky Way, is a simple galaxy which the solar system is located, within which the solar system is located. It is again contains the gas, dust and stars. Maybe billions of stars are available in this galaxy. Such kind of galaxies are many in our universe. Such kind of universes are many in the entire available in, I do not know what is the name, what we call it as. It is multiverses. We do not know beyond, it is beyond even our imagination, what could be beyond these galaxies or beyond these multiverses. Of course, a beautiful solar system has been formed with the center sun as one star, which is burning always with the hydrogen gas. Surrounding the planets like Sun, Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, with their own satellites, natural satellites, they'll be continuously moving around the sun, and the exploration is on within the solar system. Now we have even not crossed beyond the solar system, and efforts are being made even to go beyond the solar system in the future but we do not know what kind of sophistication, what kind of communication system that is required to monitor and control such kind of let us say artificial satellites. With all this curiosity, good thinkers, scientific thinkers like Kepler and Newton try to understand how this all the astronomical objects start working or start functioning. So Kepler is the pioneer who established different three laws. First law says each planet travels in an elliptical orbit. It is not the circular orbit. The radius of the vector planet sweeps out equal masses in equal periods of time. There's a second law. These are all the three scientific principles within which, whether it is a natural object or planet or natural satellite or artificial satellite, will work. So these principles, how they are applied, you will listen to the you will listen in the subsequent slides. Of course, Newton is another scientist which have established how the motion of a satellite is controlled based on, because you know, any object can have a linear axial, linear velocity. How this linear velocity will be guiding a motion, a rotation around the parent object, parent Earth or Sun or any other planet. So these are all the two scientists, we have the principles which are derived for the astronomical purposes. See, the Kepler first law, it says that it is precisely discussed geometric shape of an orbit. It is not circular orbit, it is an elliptical, where the sun or major planet is at one foci, foci, because the elliptical ellipse will have two focus, foci. So one foci will, an object will be there, it will be moving around that object. But the second law says when it is moving around that object for a period of time, the area covered by the rotating object is one and the same. That means when it comes near to the center, it goes fast, it moves fast and sweeps the equal triangle. When it is far away, it moves slow. So this is a principle with which the entire scientific objects will the satellites will work. Okay, Kepler laws, what the Newton is telling is a linear acceleration or linear velocity of any object, which is, we call it as escape velocity, is guided with the centripetal forces, centripetal accelerations, that gives the rotation around an object. So this is the Newton principle. The combination of Newton's and Kepler's laws will be made use of for the astronomical objects to move around the planets, and for us also to estimate the mission studies, to carry out the mission studies and to estimate different orbits and different velocities. That is the guiding principle for us to prepare a mission. So with what is the kind of orbit we should choose, what is the with which the satellite will move, with what velocity, accordingly our entire launch vehicle design will happen, satellite will happen. Of course, subsequently, after knowing the scientific principles, Galileo developed the beautiful microscope. With that, we started observing the sky. Then our curiosity has increased. Why can't we reach that place so that we can have clear visibility? Because when you see from Earth, a lot of dust will be there, the objects will not be cleared. But when you go up in the sky, your vision will be clear. That is why Hubble telescope has been put into operation, and lot many scientific studies we could derive out of the Hubble telescope. Of course, this is the principle. In that, there is a star or a planet around which an object will be moving. Either it could be a planet around the sun, or natural satellite around the planet, or artificial satellite around the planet. The shorter distance we call it as perigee. Then when the planet or the center object is located at one focus, the shorter distance we call it as perigee. The farthest location is called apogee. And these are all measured by the axis, major axis and minor axis of the ellipse. So coming, why at all we should explore the space? So space is a very fascinating area where we will come to know lot many scientific evolution, etc., etc. But our concern more is for observing our own Earth. for our regular day-to-day let's say requirements. We have cell phones, we have telecommunications, televisions for entertainment, meteorological applications. All these are possible only from the sky. Why? Because from the sky, your visibility will be very clear, your angle of sight would be very high, and object will cover the entire earth within no time, so that the entire data sitting at your place, you can get to know the data of the earth on the opposite side. So these are all, so many advantages are there with the artificial satellites. That is why for us to have our own day-to-day function in a better way, the satellites are required. Okay, use of artificial satellites enable astronomical observations, and which is not possible from the ground-based observatories. And for different applications, even let's say you take food security, somewhere I am in south. Let us say in north, what product is happening, what produce is being developed, agriculture produce is being developed and produced, we do not know. This satellite, it is possible to have an estimation of such kind of agricultural produce, and we can always plan ahead wherever the shortage is there, we can always plan to shift that material from surplus to scarce. So such kind of observations also more, as initially Nidhi was telling, the space applications are more predominant than the scientific observations. Scientific observations, we have missions. Okay, there is all long range missions where with one telescope or with optical sensors, we'll keep observing. But very limited community is only getting derived benefits out of the scientific missions. But our Earth observation missions, communication missions, they derive let us say support for a huge population, which is a common man. You take Earth observations, we have agricultural studies. As I told you, agricultural different cash crops can be estimated, where actually how much is being produced. We can plan the market for that, we can plan a distribution plan for that, and ultimately it can be reaching the common man in a very effective way, well ahead. The land use, smart cities. Today, the overcrowded cities, so many applications are there. You take it as water consumption, you carry it as mosquito propagation, cockroach propagation, water, let us say stagnation, let us say city light, the street lights mapping, your traffic management, so many things. It is possible only through satellites, because it is in a very affordable way. You can always plan such kind of systems using satellites. Coming to water resources, where during rainy season, a lot of catchments will be there, which you cannot see in the hilly areas and in remote areas. In upper, let us say, regions, a lot of catchment pits will be there where the water is filled. During the summertime, the water scarcity will be there. So how you map the water so that the excess water which is not being used can be diverted to the useful ponds, so that during the scarce times, the unutilized water can be utilized. So these are all possible only through satellites. Ocean applications. Now today fisheries, we are able to ocean monitor cameras, we can be able to identify potential fishing zones and advising the fisherman to go and get a good catch of the fish. It is possible. Okay, then soil irrigation, soil fertility, then soil moisture content. Based on the soil moisture, you can always plan where the actual water pump or the potential water zones are there. This is possible through satellites. Of course, disaster warning, it is known to everybody. So many cyclones otherwise could have been a catastrophe, we could avoid. Based on the studies, we could know where the cyclones are moving, in what direction they are moving. We will take appropriate action well in ahead to evacuate the people from the potential zones. That's how the disaster warning management system is a very important subject in the satellite. So like that, so many applications are there with the satellite. So in the Earth observation area, coming to the navigation, this is another application. The constellation, what we called a very popular name is USGPS, with which you can locate yourself, you can identify where your object is, you can put tracker, and you can reach your destinations. So India has constituted its own regional navigation system, which is 1500 kilometers around the country, which is named as NAVIC, which is potentially used for many industrial and individual applications. Similarly, communications, nothing to be told, whatever the entertainment, whatever the communication, you call it as ATM facilities, you call it as TV broadcasting, OTT, telemedicine, tele-education, such kind of things are supported by our Indian communication satellites. So these are all the applications, these are all very much required for us for exploring the space, and we have been doing. Okay, having noted the essentials of, let us say, space exploration for functional use, how it started. Everybody must be aware that Sputnik in 1957 has started the space race. And subsequently, Russia was leading in sending, let us say, live things to the space. Ultimately, US also joined the race, and they have declared that in the meantime, Yuri Gagarin was the first man to go into the space. Then Project Mercury has come, and Alan Shepard is the first American to go into the space. And ultimately, Apollo 13 made the man to land on the moon. It has gone and as a some kind of competition between two advanced nations at that time. But this has led to establishing the space stations for research work, because having gone one or two times to the several times to the moon, then they realized probably I think space would be the best area for doing a lot of research, either in microgravitational atmospheres or microbial studies. Then the space stations have come. One space station, Skylab, which was put in 1973 for experimental purpose. After that, Mir is another station. Of course, the current International Space Station as a collaboration is going on. So these space stations have given a platform for scientific community for carrying out a lot of research on different experiments. Okay, as I said, the race to the moon has opened a different dimension to the space for exploring beyond our gravity. First is moon gravity, then a space shuttle has become a passenger vehicle, including Soyuz, to make trips to space station and coming back safely. Unfortunately, space shuttle Challenger has led to a very unfortunate disaster, which has put a thinking process whether to continue this very costly experiment. Then, of course, ultimately, US has taken a decision to restrict themselves and opening up the private sector for doing the commercial activities for research work. So ultimately, the more focus now is on societal applications and exploring beyond. That means Mars, Jupiter, etc., Sun, maybe Shukrayan, such kind of things started for exploring other planets, whether any life is there, how these earths are formed. These are all scientific curiosity. And probably, I think, in the years to come, probably some colonization may also happen both in Moon and Mars. That's what the expectations of the scientific community are. So when the world is going like this, in India, what do we do? So basically, the space domain consists of three areas. One is ground segment, another one is space segment. How this ground segment is connected to space? In the ground segment, we have all infrastructure. In the space segment, we have all satellites, assets. So from the ground to space, how the satellites will be carried out, that is all launch vehicle. This is access to space, what we call it as space transportation system. It is depicted here. The space segment, when you have a lot of ground segment is required for operating day-to-day monitoring of the satellites, what we call it, we have several control rooms, ground stations, radars, antennas, so many other things are available for controlling the satellites and for getting the data and information and converting them into useful information to pass on to the users. So these artificial satellites have become order of the day for meeting the requirements of the common man now. So there are before going to all different satellite missions, it is better to talk about the orbits. So for each and every application, there is one orbit identified. So the lowest orbits, what we popularly call it as less than 1,000 kilometers. Medium orbits, maybe 10,000 to 20,000 kilometers. And geosynchronous orbits, 36,000 kilometers. These are all the three popular orbits. But more popular orbits are LEO and GEO, because LEO are basically for Earth observations and GEO is basically for communication. And medium Earth orbits, we use it for navigation purpose, etc., etc. See how a satellite works. See, in case of Earth observation satellites, we want our land to be covered as much as possible, as fast as possible, and as better as possible. This is possible when the satellite is near to the Earth. That is one aspect. The second aspect is why we call it as polar. It moves vertical to the rotation of the Earth, so that pole to pole it will move. And when satellite is moving from pole to pole around the Earth, it captures the information of Earth in bands. That band is called swath. So during the swath, based on the resolution of the optical camera and other sensors, the data will be captured and temporarily stored in the satellite. And wherever it comes over our ground station, we will download the data. This is how the satellite works. So most of the things are maybe 1,000 kilometers. If it is 750 kilometers, every 90, 99 to 100 minutes, one rotation will happen. So in a year, you can just imagine 24 by 1.5. So many rotations or so many revolutions are possible for a satellite, and it will capture the data. If we require other continents' data, yes, on some regulations basis, we can capture and give it for commercial applications. Otherwise, we don't capture. Why? Because it unnecessarily creating, when it is need is not there, it unnecessarily creates the overload to our onboard systems. So geosynchronous, what is geosynchronous? Geosynchronous and geostationary, there are two orbits are there. Geosynchronous is the one which always facing our own point. That means, let's say if India has to be seen always, it rotates in an angle because the Earth moves in an angular way. Always it will be positioning, the satellite always will be positioned all through looking at the India. So this is the concept of geostationary satellite. Though the velocity of the satellite is in such a way that exactly synchronizes the Earth rotation, that is, it is called geosynchronous. So these orbits are used predominantly for communication satellites. That means whatever we transfer from Earth, it will give back to us. Like there is a receiver and there is a transponder. The receiver will receive the signal and transpond it back to the Earth, so that we will be in a position to utilize the communication services of the satellites. Of course, there is another concept, Hofmann transfer orbits. Whenever we are planning the interplanetary missions, it is not possible to achieve the orbit raising or to reaching that another planet in one go. So the first is Earth rotation and Earth gravity. Another one is another planet, wherever we want to reach that rotation, that gravity. So in between, we have to maneuver the satellite in such a way that it will go to a transfer orbit, and from the transfer orbit, it will jump into the orbit of other planet. So that is the concept of this Hofmann orbit. This is a total mission studies. So is experts, you know, who are experts in this area, they will calculate, a lot of calculations are involved. Even and based on the calculations, we will exactly predict how much time it takes to go nearer to the other orbit. From there, we will just pass on some commands so that the thrusters will be fired and the satellite will be jumped to the other orbits. You take the example of Moon. So from the Earth, keep on increasing the orbit, because this is not possible since it is following the Kepler's laws. When you increase a small amount, a marginal increment in the perigee, it will create a huge increase in the apogee. So that is why whenever this comes, the satellite comes, it will fire at the apogee point, so that the increase in the orbit will take place. Ultimately, it will take a bigger ellipse, which will be closer to the moon's orbit. So when it is just about nearing about the Earth's moon's orbit, then these thrusters will be fired and the satellite will jump into the moon's gravity. Then again, it will follow the Kepler law, it will keep on rotating. At that time, we will deboost the satellite so that it will reduce the orbits, it will reduce the orbit diameter, and ultimately it will go near to the moon. So this is the mechanism normally scientists will follow from making the satellites, for moving the satellites from one planet to another planet, and maybe for one planet to another interplanet. Again, similar thing, Chandrayaan 2 is also a similar thing. When it comes to Mars, the mechanism is entirely different, because in the Mars, you have to plan in such a way that when you create a bigger ellipse, it will go beyond the Sun. So when it go, when the satellite goes beyond the Sun, the communications will be cut, because there is a hidden area. As long as the communication is not happening with the Earth station, we do not know what exactly happening to the satellite unless it reappears after a long time. So this is the criticality that is involved in the Mars mission. I am proud that we could achieve this kind of orbital mechanics in first go, because exactly we have read these orbital mechanics in the textbooks and implemented the same. Ultimately, it has been achieved. A great success was there in the first attempt itself. So this is some of the information where the Mars mission was undertaken. Of course, if you see the satellite constellation, you in and around Earth is Earth observation satellites. Beyond the thing in elliptical form, that is geosynchronous satellites. It is overcrowded. Now it is becoming, space is becoming a very alarming area where collisions may happen. That is why national space agencies are taking lot of precautions for debris management and for capturing the dead satellites and bringing it back to the Earth, or let us say taking care of the debris. We have learned, well, let's say, whatever the basic fundamentals and other things are there. Now, when it comes to the launch, what are all the different criticalities involved in the launch? There are several launch sites across the world, but very popular sites are in countries like Russia, America, China, Japan, France, etc., etc. Okay, Kourou. France is being covered by Kourou, Europe. So if you see actually how the launch site is decided, the majority of the communication, because polar launches, there is no issue at all, because it is going across the equator. When it is going to the communication satellites, the important thing is you should be near to the seashore, so that when you launch satellite, the launch vehicle, the spent stages will fall. If there is a land mass, the security point of view, it is not advisable. So that is why it is always good to have a launch pad on the seashore, so that the spent stages will fall in the seashore. That is first aspect. The second aspect is, say, range safety criteria. A launch pad should be isolated, maybe at around that depends on the amount of the mass, amount of propellant that we are using. Maybe somewhere 5 kilometers to 10 kilometers, nobody should be there around the launch pad. So if as long as the safety criteria are satisfied on a seashore, the launch pad is possible. Then what is the best launch port? So when that criteria comes into picture, so the launch port which is very close to the equator would be the best launch port. Why? Because when we are using the launch vehicle for putting the satellites into the geosynchronous orbit, it will travel very less time or less, it consumes less fuel to reach the equator plane. So that is why Kourou used to be the best because it is very near to the equator. The next best world spaceport is Satish Dhawan Space Center in our country. Okay, that's what I have just mentioned. What are the different launch directions? If you see the launch direction, the eastward directions are basically for communication satellites. Our launch direction will be launch trajectory path will be like this. We have several ground stations to cater to the for tracking the launch vehicle before it is successfully put into the orbit. This is what the path it follows normally. If it is a polar orbits, it will straight away go towards the south because there is a kink or there is a direction change because of Sri Lanka. We had to do azimuth correction. What we call it as azimuth correction. First, it will go within some inclination and take a direction and go directly to the southward. This is what I have explained. Kourou is the best. Next best is Sriharikota, Satish Dhawan Space Center. What are the types of launches? The launches are possible from the ground, vertical launches. These are the most common launches. Most of the launch agencies, space agencies will adopt to vertical launches. There are air launches, air to launch, because rocket will be carried by a huge plane and amidst maybe 10,000 feet or 10 kilometers altitude, the rocket will be fired. It is called air to launch, and sea launches are also possible because small rockets, they will be taken near to the equator and straight away they will fire onto the sea platform. Coming to the Indian space program, we have communication satellites already explained earlier. We have earth observation satellites and navigation satellite, planetary missions, manned mission, moon mission. Moon mission is there, manned mission is in the anvil. For using all these programs, we have ISRO has developed very robust launch vehicles. Initially started with the SLV and the development has gone to ASLV. Now with the knowledge of these two launch vehicles, we have developed a PSLV, very robust launch vehicle. We call it as workhorse of ISRO, which is used for all the three types of missions. That means polar missions, geosynchronous missions and navigation missions. After that, when the PSLV is restricted with the payload, because it can maximum carry 1970 kgs of payload, then the cryo technology was adopted. When the world has denied giving the technology, with the help of let us say we have imported some of the Russian stages and started understanding how the cryo technology works, and we have developed our own cryo technology cryo stage CUSP, which is used for GSLV Mark II as a third stage. So with that knowledge, the entire complete indigenized launch vehicle Mark III, which will cater to 4-ton class, has been developed and successfully tested in the first attempt itself without fail. The first D1 flight itself was successful. These are all some of the information about the PSLV. PSLV is a four-stage vehicle. First and third stages are solid, and second and third to fourth stages are liquid. GSLV, first stage is solid, and second stage is liquid, and third stage is cryo. And GSLV Mark III, again, first two strap-ons are solid, they are ground lit. In between the core, that is liquid stage, and the upper one is cryo stage. And ISRO is also embarking on space recovery experiment, so that the cost of launch vehicle is huge. If you can reuse this vehicle, it will be the cost will be saved. Of course, safe recovery experiments is basically for human space program. Okay, we are embarking on space recovery experiments. When the module goes up to the air, how to safely get it back, whether it is sea landing or land landing, and what are the technologies involved when it is cutting the atmosphere? Huge amount of temperatures will be developed, and the metallic module may get burned. So for that one, lot of let us say ceramic coatings and a lot of thermal protection system has to be adopted. That experiments have been completed. After the deployment of parachutes, these are all completed, which are leading to the human space mission. This is another winged body, what we call it as, like a shuttle. So we are also working on the space reusable launch vehicle. Experiments are over, technology demonstration has been completed, and scaling up has to be done. Air breathing engine is another concept which ISRO is working on. So when the fuel is to be taken up in the air, the weight of the fuel is another burden. So fuel anyhow, it is unavoidable, but air is available in the atmosphere. So why can't we take air from the atmosphere so that the weight of oxygen can be avoided? So that is the concept behind it. The fuel will be supplied from a tank and air will be sucked or drawn from the atmosphere so that both can be made use of for firing and for creating the thrust to the vehicle. This is called air breathing engine. So some developments are happening on the Gaganyaan mission. Gaganyaan mission is on anvil. The unmanned mission is targeted because some delay is there because of this pandemic. Otherwise, this year end, we are targeting the first unmanned flight. Lot of experiments have taken place. Lot of things are on the anvil. So ultimately, I am just going to the final phase of how a satellite launch vehicle is produced and how a launch vehicle satellite is produced. Inside the propellant plant, in case of solid motors, the stages, the motor cases are manufactured and brought to the solid propellant plant. The propellant is prepared and the motor cases are filled with the propellant. That's what we call it as motor. These are all the different operations that are involved in the solid motor production, right from insulation lining, casting, and the NDT testing, whether the core is proper or not. If at all any problem is there with the core, it will lead to catastrophe during the launch. So several tests will be done before actually we make the rocket motor flight worthy. So for that, we use the ground facilities. Because these ground facilities, ground testing is used only for the first time. And the rocket motor, once it is qualified and structurally it is proven, then we will keep on producing the rocket motors. These are all the ground tests when solid motor is be fired on the ground using the horizontal test fixtures and measure the parameters. So when once all the parameters are proven, then we will declare the design is perfect, then we'll go for productionization. And liquid motors also in the same way, the tanks are produced and the engine is manufactured. Combined, we will test. These facilities are in Mahendragiri near to Kanyakumari. After the ground testing is over, we will declare that these stages are flight worthy and we will induct into the launch vehicle systems. Satellites, as far as satellites are concerned, a lot of subsystems are manufactured in the industry. They are brought to the satellite assembly centers where the satellites are assembled and tested. Vigorous testing is required. You call it as radiation testing, EMC testing, then solar panel deployment testing, then gravity inertia testing. So many tests, and ultimately they will be put into thermovac before finally it is sent to the launch pad for integration. Once the thermovac is over, the entire satellite is sealed, I should say. Okay. Then after that, only the successful testing will be done, the final test, before it is dispatched to the launch pad. At the launch pad, all the stages, whatever I have individually developed, they are assembled one after the other, one over the other. That is, we call it as stage preparation facilities. After that, each stage will be assembled on the launch pad in vertical condition. Huge facilities are available in the our launch pad for integration purpose. Each and every facility is 80 meters tall with 400 tons EOT crane on the top for handling the stages. All the stages will be handled from integration facilities in horizontal direction using the transport vehicles and get assembled one over the other. This is the mosaic of different stage assembly operations at the launch pad. When once the launch vehicle is assembled on the pedestal, this pedestal along with the vehicle will be towed near to the launch pad, and the launch will happen. There are two criteria here. One is the launch assembly building. Another one is launch pad. I think subsequently you will see it. We have two launch pads. One is second launch pad, where the launch vehicle assembly building is static, and launch pad is launch vehicle will move on the rail near to the launch pad. So this we call it as ITL, integrate, transfer, and launch. Whereas we have another launch complex, that is first launch pad, where the assembly building will be moving. This assembly building, whatever you see in the blue color, that is around 70-75 meter tall, which will weigh 4,500 tons, which will be moving on the rail. Once after the rocket is launched on the launch pad, the building will be withdrawn maybe 200 to 300 meters away from the launch pad, so that the building will not be damaged during the launching process. This is the aerial view of Sriharikota, where both the launch pads are seen. And huge amount of fuel is required for filling up during the last phases of launch countdown. These are very hazardous fuels, which will be kept away, maybe 6 to 7 kilometers away from the launch pad. They are stored, kept in a very high vigilance, and they will be transported through pipeline to the launch pad and filled into the launch vehicle towards the end of the countdown period. Of course, satellite also initially they will be tested at launch pad, the solar panel deployment test, etc., and they will ensure that satellite is perfectly well. Then it will be transported to the launch vehicle for final assembly. So during the launching, lot of radars are there. So many radars are there. They will track and see that the launch vehicle is following the intended trajectory, so that in case of any failure, a call will be taken to even blast the vehicle during telecommand. The weather is another important criteria, which requires a lot of clearances during the launch, because rain is not the main criteria. Thunders is only the main criteria for taking the decision of launching. Why? Because thunders creates a lot of discharge. This discharge will harm our launch systems, both electronic systems as well as propellant fuel systems. So on the day of launch, so many engineers and so many scientists will be sitting in front of the controls. They will be monitoring so many parameters 24/7 and give the final decision for launching. This is the mission control center, where the launch authorization board, including chairman ISRO and several different directors of the centers, they will sit, monitor, and they will authorize the launch on the final day and final moment. So this is the gigantic vehicle lifting off. I have a small video so that you can get a view of it, how the integration will be done, how gigantic the launch vehicle systems are. This is the GSLV Mark II vehicle, which is assembled in the second launch pad. There are different platforms with which we can access the launch vehicle. When once the complete launch integration is completed, it will be towed to the launch pad on a mobile launch pedestal. The mobile launch pedestal will be operated using a bogey on the bottom with wheels. And ultimately, this bogey will position the launch vehicle along with the mobile launch pedestal in front of the launch pad. And on the day of launch and at the moment the zero down this one is counted, the vehicle will be fired. So ISRO is working with various missions keeping a very tough target in the mind, maybe up to 2025, 2030. Now we have made another decade plan up to 30. Lot of activities are on the anvil, and one after the other, with the directions of the government, ISRO is working on. Hope that this presentation made you some enrichment in your knowledge and enthusiasm. Because of the paucity of time, I could not cover everything. I had rushed. Probably, I think when some other series are happening, we can zero down. We can concentrate more on the specified topics. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, sir, for the exciting session. You explained everything right from the Big Bang theory to the rocket propulsion, the launch pads. It's enormous data is there. Thank you so much, sir. The questions are there. I'm taking some of them. The very first question is, what do you think, what is black hole? And do you think that there is any life to exist in any other planet besides Earth?
Okay, black hole is the one which has got enormous amount of gravitational pull, what we call it as. If you just contract something, some matter into infinitely small, let us say, you know how a solid can be converted into gas. Gas can be converted into liquid with high pressure. Liquid oxygen is there, liquid hydrogen is there. What you do, if you increase the pressure, you can convert into liquid. If you further increase it, it will become solid. It will further increase it. You keep on increasing million times. What will happen? That is called black hole. It will have an abundant amount of this earth also. Have what is the core of the earth? How the gravitation has happened? It is because of infinitesimally compression. That compression only created the lot of gravitational force, what we call it as. Black hole is that kind of system where huge amount of compression has taken place under heavy pressure. Of course, Earth, whether habitant is there or not, we do not know. That's what we are exploring. I think some more exploration should tell us whether really there is a life elsewhere.
Thank you, sir. So the next question is when we are going in space. Through space shuttle, does the human feel any type of pressure or push or any type of forces?
Yes. See, when especially during takeoff, huge amount of vibration will be there. Huge amount of vibration, and they have to sustain. And G is at the order of 6 to 7. So that means you just imagine a giant wheel. You just imagine a giant wheel when it is falling. What kind of feeling you will get? That is only maybe a decimal fraction of the G what you feel. Maybe 1.2 G, 1.3 G. You just imagine when it is 7 G, what kind of feeling you will have? The same feeling one will have.
Okay, sir. So the next question is, what are the satellites that have been used to monitor the weather in Indian region?
See, whether megatropics is there, InSat systems are there. There are so many satellites which are exclusively for weather, and some of the satellites are both for communication and weather. InSat series satellites, megatropics, they monitor the weather. SARAL, megatropics, such kind of these satellites.
Okay, thank you, sir. How ISRO is managing all these work during the pandemic?
See, whatever the other people are managing, we are also managing the same thing. See, why? Because see, mostly our works are research works are confined to within the centers. Only travel has been affected because for launching, we have to travel. All the scientists have to travel to Sriharikota for launching, for integration, for inspection, etc. For inspecting our subsystems, we have to travel outside. So to that extent, we got different. But our regular day-to-day research works within our center, it was going on.
Thank you, sir. So the next question is, by 2030, how many rockets or space rockets will ISRO about to launch?
We have a manifest because we have a manifest every year. We, based on the customer requirements, we prepare the manifest. And we will launch, because we will plan long-term, long-range missions. We will plan, let's say, you call it as Shukrayaan, you call it as Chandrayaan 3, you call it as, let's say, Mangalyaan 2, we call it as Aditya. Such kind of space missions we will plan well ahead, because it requires 4 to 5 years for them to realize. But regular launches, that all depends on commercial activities. Let's say if somebody comes for requesting for satellite launch, if they bring satellite, we have to manage the launch vehicle. Okay, then launch vehicle, approximately it will take 250 to 300 days in a parallel sense. Okay, if you come to know that another after 250 days, I am going to get a satellite for launching, we will plan today. Because up to 2030, we have a plan. We are expecting that at around 10 to 12 launches will happen. That's what our expectation is. But ground realities have to be actually assessed based on the time.
Thank you, sir. So the next question is, what happened if the spacecraft gone out of fuel during the mission? And is there any system through which we can refuel the spacecraft?
See, spacecraft refueling is available. In India, we don't have, we are yet to, it is called docking. So satellite, when, see, the life of the satellite is depend on, is decided based on the amount of fuel that satellite tank has got. When satellite tank is emptied, then we call it as the satellite life is gone. Why? Because there is no possibility for us to correct the orbits. Because satellite is basically measured based on the position, based on the inclination, based on the attitude, such kind of things. So when a small drift is there because of air friction or any reason, so we will correct it using thrusters. For firing the thrusters, fuel is required. When fuel is exhausted, we cannot operate the thrusters. And when the thrusters cannot be operated, the sight and the line of sight, the orientation will be changed. So that satellite is no longer useful for us. Then we call it as dead. It is dead means the physically the satellite is moving in the same orbit. After the fuel is consumed, that we call it as debris. This debris is very harmful. Now, yes, so many satellites are going into the different orbits, both LEO and GEO. So we should be very careful in future. We should have mitigation plans well in advance while launching the satellite itself. We should plan for a mitigation and see that when it is nearing to the end of the life, we should see that this satellite will be pushed to the very high altitudes, so that it will take maybe million years to come back to the Earth's atmosphere.
Sure, so the next question is, what is the role of biology in the field of space sciences? How biology can be related?
See, biology, sir, human space missions, biology is only the concern. Because, see, one astronaut is going, see, his safety is monitored by his health. His health will be monitored by biological systems. So ELSS is a system, what we call it as his health monitoring, his food, his, let us say, natural calls, such kind of things are very in the space environment. Even a smallest water droplet will cause civil catastrophe. Imagine a small water droplet is flying in the air, if by any chance it's got infected and enter into eye, it is not possible to get cured so fast as if you are on the earth and you don't have mechanisms to incubate yourself or isolate yourself. So human biological science is a very, very important subject for space sciences, especially for human space missions.
Thank you so much, sir, for so patiently answering all the questions throughout the session. Arvind, sir, if you have any questions or something to say.
I think, as you correctly said, great amount of questions have been addressed by Sridhar Sudhirji. And it was really a pleasure to listen to him. I only have one question that, especially when we are looking at the manned mission and all, and the first one, the try that we are going to have is what we call it as
Gaganyaan.
Gaganyaan. So what is the timeline for the Gaganyaan that is been planned, and is there any change likely to happen because of the pandemic time?
No, because pandemic correction has already been announced by our chairman. Because otherwise it should have been 21 end is the target for Gaganyaan. Now because of pandemic, it is shifted by 1 year. It is already one unmanned flight is already in the news. So unmanned flight we are targeting towards the end of this year. Another unmanned flight in another 6 months, and manned flight most likely during the end of next year.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for a wonderful question answer session. And we really feel so great to have you on our platform. And I look forward to have many more such interactions with you because ISRO is close to everyone's heart. And when you listen, when we all listen to you, it have altogether a very different kind of atmosphere and a different orientation. So we look forward to have you on our platform again and again, especially when the new missions have been in place and new findings are there from these.
Most welcome, Arunji. We are also very happy to share whatever the scientific developments are happening in ISRO with the people. It is the one way or other, you should get benefited by all the students community as well as the learners. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir, for giving time for our lecture series. I also thank all the viewers who every week who come to us and watch our lecture series and make it successful. Thank you, everyone. See you in the next lecture.